Yes.
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 I do know who he is, yes.
Jonathan has stood alongside state leaders, accompanied some of the best sports teams in the country. However, for a name so ambiguous, many do not know his rich history. Why Jonathan, or who chose a Husky? Well, you did. In 1934, someone complained to the Daily Campus, and one student poll later, voila! A cute 14-week-old Husky whose ancestors went on the first expedition to the North Pole. Name choice? Jonathan Trumbull, after the first governor of Connecticut. What happened after? Well, he was run over. 3 months later. After that traffic violation, it was history from there.
Introduced in 1935, Jonathan II scared Brown University's actual bear mascot of the free running basketball game. 1947, Jonathan III continued the tradition by chasing Yale's bulldog around the football field. 1949, Jonathan IV bit the nose of the bulldog in a growl when points were scored against UConn. 1959, Jonathan V was not a fan of loud noises and big crowds. Reporters even described him as shell shocked. But in 1963, UConn replaced him with a costume mascot. 1963, Jonathan VI, short-lived, was hit by a car. 1964, Jonathan VII was nearly sold as a protest against the Vietnam War after he was introduced. Jonathan VIII existed, not much information about him. Jonathan IX or X, there was a weird debate over which one existed, as per Alpha Phi Omega's history. Jonathan X was run over. Jonathan XI came right after the women's basketball team won its first NCAA national championship in 1995 and the unveiling of the famous Husky Dog statue in front of Gamble. Jonathan XII, like the fifth, was scared by stadium crowds. Jonathan's caretakers revamped the policies in his wake, requiring the involvement of Jonathan's host family in his handling and the hiring of a full-time professional handler. Jonathan XIII was beloved instantly when he was introduced, described as rambunctious and sassy. This Jonathan lived well into his senior years and kept the younger Jonathan XIV company. He retired in 2014 due to growing sensitivity to loud noises. The current best boy, Jonathan XIV, is from Arkansas and is a traditional black and white husky with blue eyes.
Jonathan has a large history behind him. Let's now take a look at UConn's current Jonathan, seeing what the day in the life of this famous dog really is. 5:30 a.m. Wake up. 7. Breakfast. 8. Doggy daycare. 11. Back home for a nap. 12 p.m. Campus walk with Alpha Phi Omega handlers. 1 p.m. Come back home and be cute. 2. Visit Fenton River Veterinary Hospital for 3-month checkup. 2:30. Take a trip to favorite store, Pet Valu, and possibly get a bath. Not fun. 5. Play around with Jonathan XIII and go for a walk. 5:30, dinner time. And lastly, 7. Alpha Phi Omega chapter meeting. Even in Jonathan's chaotic life, room is made for rest and leisure. But there have been challenges in the past for Jonathan, not to mention the dog nappings and the whole getting run over 4 times part.
At the basketball game, like the first women's basketball game of the season, he was walking by on the court and they set off like a little smoke cannon and he like frightened away.
And the concern over this is valid. UConn's home stadium seats 40,000 people, a chaotic and overwhelming sensory experience, hearing sounds 4 times farther away than we can, more frequency range and better directionality. Take Jonathan II chasing a bear up a tree, or Jonathan V biting a bulldog on the nose. These type of incidents have also made headlines at other universities. But by all accounts, Jonathan lives a luxurious life at UConn. Alpha Phi Omega, as laid out by their Husky policy, takes care of Jonathan quite well.
Please tell me your name and your occupation.
Sure. Tracy Cree. I am currently a program manager here in facilities at UConn. and I have worked at the university for about 18 years. So I've been an advisor to Alpha Phi Omega for, I think, a little over 10 years. Right towards the beginning of advising, the Husky Committee within Alpha Phi Omega needed a person to help them with everything Jonathan. When he hears clapping, even on the TV, if you ever have them, when you know whether it's like you're watching Wimbledon or something and people clap, he's like, oh, you know, you could almost see him like straighten up and smooth his hair back because he's like, oh, they're talking about, they're looking at me and they're clapping. They've been in parades, they've attended football games, basketball games. We don't go to games that have fireworks. That just introduces a whole different kind of sound that is not, I don't think, positive for an animal. When they ring the bell for the touchdowns, we have him moved away from that and like on the other side of the stadium. It rings in my ears, so I assume it's going to ring in his, and that's how we go. So the handlers move him. If we score any points, they move him.
There is a balance. Of course, dogs get overstimulated, but also they need stimulus to survive, especially huskies. Like, that's a very high energy breed. So I can see like the mental work of, you know, socializing with students and being at sports games actually being like very enriching for him.
Animal mascots also play a big part in the university's spirit, pride, and tradition. Jonathan is more than 14 generations of Husky. It's the name of our sports team. You rub his nose for good luck. He's been around for 88 years. His colors run in the university's literal blood.
I'm Joe Briety. I'm Assistant Vice President of Student Affairs and Executive Director of Student Activities here at UConn. I oversee about 55 professionals engaged in various student activities on campus. I'm a graduate of UConn about 100 years ago, and as is many members of my family, and as you know, once served as the mascot for the university. So, like I said, a lot of us, surprisingly, have been in the suit over the years. It actually started with my older brother, who attended in the late 70s and early 80s, and he was a mascot. And ran around for 2 years, his junior and senior year, in the suit. And when I came to the university as an undergrad, he had suggested it might be something I'd be interested in doing. And by my senior year, I was. So I tried out and got the gig and did that for my senior year. I think it brings obviously a level of spirit and pride. I think whether you're an alum, or frankly, you're a three-year-old kid at a ball game, seeing the mascots, very easily identifiable, the look. You get yells from across the room and across the field and the court. People saying hi to Jonathan. Folks are so excited when you go up and greet them. It helps kind of build that community and that identity. Going up to Syracuse and being the mascot in the Carrier Dome, in front of a crowd of tens of thousands of Syracuse fans, was an intimidating experience to be, obviously, the mascot, the UConn mascot, in front of Syracuse fans. But I will say one of the probably most interesting and happy memories that I have is that I actually met my wife when I was in the suit, and so I'd be in trouble if I didn't mention that. You would run into the four-legged dog at events and so forth. They weren't always really happy. They were a little standoffish when they saw, like I said, it's 6 foot, you know, 5 or 6 foot, you know, furry dog. I'm going to say this as a fan, not as an administrator. I think the distinction here is important. So as a fan, I do think about sometimes the Husky slide coming back and what that might bring to the experience, both the mascot and the fans in the, you know, in the arena or whatever, because that was kind of a neat thing. But I also understand why it stopped, right? So as a fan, I miss it. As an administrator, you know, I'm like, I'm not sure that's a great idea, you know. So that's something, you know, I like to think about in the future and so forth. But I think otherwise, just kind of carrying on the tradition of really being this spark and this point of very visible, tangible, engaging point of spirit and excitement at UConn events is really kind of neat. And a little bit of the wildness of the dog that, you know, he's able to do because he's a person in a dog suit, you know, which is kind of crazy thought. I think continuing that would be great.
Like many other universities, we've subbed our live mascot out at most games for a costumed one. Joe's family has taken part for many generations in the tradition of donning the fur suit. Another strong reminder of Jonathan's presence is the coveted Husky statue on campus. In 1995, it immortalized the imprint of Jonathan on our university. It has since become a good luck tradition to rub the nose of that very statue for good luck.
Well, hi, I'm Larry Wassley, and I live in Gurleyville, Connecticut, which is about a mile from Horse Barn Hill off campus. I'm a professional painter, sculptor, illustrator, whatever feeds my family pretty much in the arts. I'm really excited to sit down and talk about something that means a lot to me. And I moved here, I was 11, and my dad took me to a game. The first thing I wanted to do was go meet the mascot that they walked around on a leash. And there was a lot of mascots over the years, and I probably petted every single one of them. There was a committee of people from all over the campus, the head of the fine arts department. They didn't want it done in the fine arts building. And I'm like, you guys got a foundry, we can do it here. And they're like, no, we don't want to confuse it with the state and the property and all that. Harry Hartley was the president at the time. And he was a really good friend. We wanted to reflect the community of Connecticut and the fact that UConn is not an urban school. It's not in downtown like Rutgers or something. So we put a lot of very cool plantings. People ask me about the shiny nose, what I think of that. I think that means people are touching my work and that they have some kind of passion for it. And so after graduation, that is polished gold, you know, it is beautiful. And then it slowly turns brown within a few months, but it means that people were trying to get something from it, like a little piece of luck or thank you or an admission that they liked it. But probably the coolest story was I was there one day, kind of a warm day, and there was this old guy, and he had a big, long, black, heavy coat and a hat on. And he was walking around my statue for quite a while, touching the whole thing and everything. And I looked up and he had tears, you know? I'm like, are you okay? He goes, sure would like to meet the guy who made this. I said, why would you want to do that? And he said, because I kept the first dog ever on campus. To put it in bronze like that means they were important, and the school has one symbol, not 50 different logos. It has one logo, it has one symbol, and the Husky embodies that. This guy, Mr. Saltis, who worked in publications at UConn, said, would you like to sketch a new logo? They had this three-cornered hat guy standing with a musket. And I went, yeah, I think we could do better. And he said, you know, and the face that they were using was very smooshed looking. It wasn't really dimensional. And it was used for a long time. And I had always wanted to redo it and have somebody ask me. But I was working, and my friend Jeff was sitting in my studio, and he's like, why don't you use your dog Surf, man? He's got a great look on his face and his eyes, nose, and mouth. All these chicks come up to him and they love the dog and they think he's like really cool. And he's not violent looking. He's just a big dog that's happy. So I put his eyes, nose, and mouth on it that night, drew it, and it was it.